Hey everybody, Brion McClanahan here. Are you looking for a great website that gives you history the way it was intended to be told, with no PC, no Marxism, no progressivism? Well, I've got it for you. It's learntruehistory.com. That's learntruehistory.com. Learn history from great professors who don't sugarcoat it for you. This is not for your delicate flowers. That's learntruehistory.com. LearnTrueHistory.com. This is the Brion McClanahan Show. 3, 2, 1, 0. Welcome back to the Brion McClanahan Show. This is episode 86. Glad to have you back on the program. Glad to be here. Before we get started today, just want to remind everyone about my forthcoming book, How Alexander Hamilton Screwed Up America. It's going to be available September 18th, but there's great news. Even though it doesn't come out till September, you've got time to pre-order it. You're going to want to do that. You're not going to want to wait till September to get it. Here's why. If you go out and pre-order it at your favorite retailer, you can go to Amazon.com or BarnesandNoble.com. I'm not sure Books A Million has it yet, but they will. So right now it's Amazon and Barnes & Noble, but if you pre-order it anywhere that's got it, and you send me a screenshot of your purchase to blamehamilton@gmail.com. So just email it to blamehamilton@gmail.com. Email that screenshot. I will send you a free ebook, The Jeffersonian Solution. If you order two or more, pre-order two or more. Now, only a couple of people have taken me up on this offer so far. This is the best part. If you pre-order two or more, I will not only send you the free ebook, I will send you a 6-lecture course on Alexander Hamilton. You can't get that anywhere else. So if you order two or more, you get the course. If you order one, and the ebook. If you order one, you get the ebook. And everyone that pre-orders the book, whether you order one, two, or 20, will be registered for a drawing for the grand prize, which is a master level membership to libertyclassroom.com. So you're going to want to do that. Also, there will be a second and third place prize, too. Second place prize is a basic plus membership, and the third place prize is a basic membership. So you're going to want to go out there and do that and get in on the giveaways. So a lot of great stuff. Pre-order the book. Comes out September 18th. Really excited about it. So go out there and pick that up. Also, just want to remind you, if you like this podcast, please share it around on social media. Go out to Facebook, like me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter, like my YouTube page, get out there, and please support the podcast. Okay, so today's episode is going to be focused on someone that I've written about in two different books, and that's Andrew Jackson. And the reason I'm going to do this today is because, of course, we've got the very famous Jackson statue in New Orleans, Louisiana, that is now under attack. This was predicted and predictable. The group Take 'Em Down NOLA has decided that not only are they going to take down Confederate monuments around New Orleans, they also want to take down the Andrew Jackson statue, and I think even Joan of Arc is scheduled to be taken, or at least they're trying to attack Joan of Arc, from what I understand. Not scheduled to be taken down, but they're attacking it, and they'd like to take it down. The other thing, of course, about this particular situation, we've got statues, Confederate statues on private property that are being attacked, put graffiti on, vandalized, these kind of things. So this is just the beginning. And I was watching the show Turn last night, which is a AMC show about Washington spy ring. And it's based on actual events. And there was this very interesting exchange. There are, of course, slaves in the show. You know, New York had slavery at the time, and so there was this, the center of the show was New York, and they've gotten into a little bit of detail about the British emancipation efforts. But in one particular scene last night, in the very first episode of this final season of the show, season 4, there was a former slave who had gone in and served with the British, and then he came back to go find his wife or girlfriend. I don't know if they were actually married or not, but anyways, I think it was his girlfriend. Came back to find her, and she had gone into the American line. She had helped out the American cause, and he came across a slave, or I should say a former slave, in New York, and this particular slave said, "I'm a runaway from Mount Vernon, and Washington's never going to allow us slaves to do anything, but we have to run away. He's never going to give us our freedom." So here we are in a show, popular culture show, and of course now George Washington's under attack. This is indicative of the time. And so how long is it before George Washington statues of George Washington are taken down, or Thomas Jefferson, or James Madison? I know that Kevin Gutzman has been on the air in Wisconsin for a school that is trying to rename James Madison High School, because of course James Madison was a slave owner, and you can't have that. So here we are, and this is the situation we're in. And of course Andrew Jackson now is under attack. And I went through an exchange with some millennial on social media, and I was commenting on a post that my nephew had put up about this issue, and I just made a comment, and of course about the issue, and one millennial said, "Well, yeah, I mean Andrew Jackson has to come down because he killed Indians for sport, for fun." So essentially, the perception of Andrew Jackson is this guy went out there and just hunted Indians for fun. I mean, this is what he did. So we've got a real disconnect here with Andrew Jackson. I've never read anywhere that said Andrew Jackson went out and sport hunted Indians. That just didn't happen. But of course, Andrew Jackson now has become a target. And there's much to like about Andrew Jackson. There's also much to not like about Andrew Jackson. So I thought I would do a little podcast on Jackson and give you two perspectives on Jackson. I wrote about Andrew Jackson in my Politically Incorrect Guide to Real American Heroes. I also wrote about Andrew Jackson in my 9 Presidents Who Screwed Up America. So on one hand, I am calling Andrew Jackson an American hero. On the other hand, I'm saying Andrew Jackson screwed up America. So how can I say both? Well, fairly easy. Andrew Jackson was a real American hero. There's no doubt about it. The man was one of the most important Americans in American history. He was also a very bad president in many ways. He did a couple of good things as president, and I'll mention that. But I think it's important to understand Andrew Jackson's complexities and why I think that taking down Andrew Jackson would be a bad idea. Okay, taking John Jackson's statue would be a bad idea. I think that Andrew Jackson, just like all these Confederate monuments that are under attack, should be left up, regardless of the current fashion about contextualization or simply removing them because they might offend somebody. You even find in these former Eastern Bloc countries, they still have statues up to the communist leaders in some of these places. Now, I know that Lenin and other Stalin was taken down, but in some cases, particularly war memorials, they have monuments up to these communists who were fighting in World War II, for example. So they still have these war memorials up, even though the Communist Party, with a hammer and sickle on it, right? Even though the Communist Party has become seen as bad across much of the Eastern Bloc. There are still, people out there that love the Communist Party, of course, and want to bring it back. But they still have these war memorials up there, so it's amazing. We're the only country that decides to take down what amount to war memorials. All right, so let's talk about Andrew Jackson first. Why I think Andrew Jackson was and is a real American hero. So he's actually, again, in my book, The Politically Incorrect Guide to Real American Heroes. And he's in the chapter with David Crockett, not Daniel Boone, but David Crockett. And that's interesting. It was fun to put those two together because Crockett and Jackson ended up not liking each other very much. Crockett actually ran against Andrew Jackson's party when he was elected to Congress. He ran against Jackson's record. Because he thought that Jackson was abusing power. He thought Jackson had supported things that he shouldn't support. One of those things was the Bank of the United States. And so we have this perception of Jackson as this great warrior against the bank. But that only came later when he figured out that Henry Clay was behind the bank, rechartering the bank, and Andrew Jackson hated Henry Clay. And so he'd want to support something that Henry Clay supported and thought was a good idea. Now, why was Jackson a hero, though? So I think Jackson's a hero for his life before that point. So Andrew Jackson grew up, of course, in the shadow of the American War for Independence. He was a teenager near the end of the war. Both of his brothers served, and Jackson nominally served. And this is why sometimes he's called a member of the founding generation. I don't think so. He's a little too young. He was only 13 years old. That's like saying John Quincy Adams was a member of the founding generation, and John Quincy Adams was not. Even though John Quincy Adams was over in Europe with his father during the war as essentially a secretary, you can't say that Adams was somehow a member of the founding generation. Jackson didn't really take part in any of the debates about the writing of the Constitution or the ratification of the Constitution. He did go into Congress very early on, and Thomas Jefferson knew him and actually called Jackson a very dangerous man. So there is that perception that Andrew Jackson was just not a very good guy. Now, he grew up on the frontier, the very rough world of the frontier. He had a hot temper. He was interesting. I always tell my students this. Andrew Jackson, when he was a man, by the time he became a man, was 6'1" and about 130 pounds. So he was tall and very thin and wiry. And this was not uncommon for men not to weigh a whole lot. They didn't have a whole lot to eat back in the late 18th and early 19th century. They weren't able to sit down and stuff their faces. Now, you did have people like Henry Knox who had about five chins, but most men were not overweight, and they had a lot of physical activity, including Andrew Jackson. The man did love to fight. He fought over a dozen duels in his lifetime and carried a bullet in his shoulder from Thomas Hart Benton for most of his adult life. Thomas Hart Benton, by the way, was a man who was not for the Bank of the United States. And I think when you look at that, you know, Benton was principled in that way. Jackson came around to it later. And in fact, the two guys, even though they had fought a duel against each other, eventually reconciled enough to go after the bank together. So that's an interesting little side note. But Jackson is criticized for being a quote-unquote Indian hunter or Indian hater. I mean, and he actually gained a reputation As a younger man, during the War of 1812, Jackson led a militia group into what's now Alabama during the War of 1812 and took part in what's called the Creek War. The Creek War was a civil war in the Creek Nation. You had one side of the Creeks called the White Sticks fighting with the United States against another side of the Creeks called the Red Sticks fighting against the United States. And this was a really nasty conflict. On both sides, the Creek had massacred a number of Americans at a place called Fort Mims near Mobile, Alabama, and the Red Sticks had. And this included women and children. And that was not uncommon in frontier warfare. So we have this this perception of the Indians today as being these noble people who never did anything wrong. And there's a reason that people like Thomas Jefferson called them merciless savages, because their warfare, as he wrote in the Declaration, would target anyone, men, women, and children. And if the American Indians moved through a village and attacked it, they would leave no one alive. There was a very famous battle during the American War for Independence in the New York area, and an entire village was attacked, and they finished everyone off. And so in reprisal, the Americans went out and did the same thing to an American Indian village. So this was nasty stuff. When you had the warfare on the frontier during the Northwest Indian War in the early years of the Washington administration, the Battle of the Wabash, where Arthur St. Clair was ambushed, even though Washington told him not to get ambushed, well, he was ambushed. Everyone that was left there trying to fight the American Indians were killed, and in fact thrown into fires alive. So these guys were not good guys, the American Indians, when it came to warfare on the frontier. There's a reason why people like Joseph Brant during the war was one of the most feared military commanders. Joseph Brant was a Mohawk Indian, and he had no quarter for anyone, man, woman, or child, that came and got in his way when he was attacking a village or attacking an outpost. So the same thing was going on here in the Creek Nation. In fact, one of the leaders of the Creek, a man named William McIntosh, who signed a treaty with the United States, was eventually barricaded in his house and burned alive by the by the Creek Indians. So here was one of their leaders. They did this. So the Creek Indian had a pretty severe form of warfare. Now, what happened in this particular war was not uncommon. You had men who were fairly vicious in warfare on both sides. There was a very famous episode where a number of Creek Indians were burned alive in a hut in one of the battles. These were soldiers, those were warriors. So when you look at Indian warfare on the frontier, this was pretty brutal stuff, and Jackson took part in that. Of course, Jackson also gained fame during this war for his defense of New Orleans during the War of 1812. And so when you look at taking down the statue of Andrew Jackson, this is the guy that saved New Orleans from the British. When he was fighting with, this is also the interesting part, you have these take-him-down people in New Orleans saying Jackson was a racist, slaveholder, Indian hater. The fact is, Andrew Jackson, at the Battle of New Orleans in 1815, was fighting with the native peoples of New Orleans, many of whom were Creole and Creole Indian, or Creole New Orleans residents, were mulattoes, many of them. So he's fighting with mixed blood people, not all white people, against the British, who are all white. So the Creole that helped defend New Orleans, these militia, in many cases, some of them were pirates and other things, and helping Andrew Jackson out. I mean, it was a mixed race army in a lot of ways. So it's amazing to me that Jackson is this guy that's seen as this, you know, guy that you know, hates people of color. It just wasn't true. Of course, Jackson was a slave owner, and he did go out and fight Indians, but that was a sign of the times. So defending New Orleans, he's fighting with the people of New Orleans against invasion. And of course, before the battle, Jackson goes out and prays with a group of nuns. He wasn't Catholic, but prayed with a group of nuns there just outside of New Orleans. And after they won the battle, then every year he would go back to this convent that he could and pray with these nuns again, because he looked at it as divine intervention that these Americans won this Battle of New Orleans, at one time considered one of the greatest victories in American history. It's what made Jackson a household name. So Jackson from there goes out, and when the war is over, he still stays in the southeast region. And at one point, of course, the Seminole Indians in Florida rise up against Americans there, and they were being egged on by the British. And so Jackson marches into Florida, into Pensacola, actually, and captures a couple of British officials and executes them, and also starts essentially this Seminole Indian War. Becomes famous or infamous. The Seminole Indians never had an official peace treaty with the United States. But in the process, you know, he creates an international problem, which leads to the acquisition of Florida. John Quincy Adams, of the Adams-O'Neill Treaty, signs Florida into an American possession during the Monroe administration. And of course, Jackson's seen as an Indian hater for this, because he's fighting the Seminole Indians. But the Seminole Indians were raiding into American territory, American states, and attacking Americans. And they were being egged on by the British. Again, he's defending Americans. So this was not hunting Indians for sport. This was simply defending American property and lives from attack. So the man can't win for losing. Now, of course, Jackson then becomes the United States Senator, and then he's elected president. So all of this stuff that I just talked about, this is why I say Jackson was a real American hero. He's out defending Americans. He's out defending American property and American lives from attack, from foreigners, the British, from Indian raids. And I think that that's something we should admire Andrew Jackson for. His statue, of all the statues in New Orleans, Andrew Jackson's statue there should stay, just for that reason alone, for the Battle of New Orleans and defending New Orleans from the British. He also has a statue there in Pensacola in a place called Jackson Square. They have an outline of the fort that Jackson built in Pensacola. They've excavated the base of the fort, and they have a big bust of Andrew Jackson there because he defended Pensacola from the British and, of course, Indian attacks. And So where's what's the hate here? This guy was a real American hero. Now, Jackson becomes president and all things change. And so in Nine Presidents Who Screwed Up America, I get into why I think Jackson screwed up America as president. So I will give him credit for vetoing the rechartering of the bank bill. That is one thing that Andrew Jackson did. There's another thing, too, I'll mention. But one thing that Andrew Jackson did that was laudable, but it wasn't principled. Andrew Jackson didn't oppose the bank because he was against central banking. He opposed the bank because Henry Clay was behind rechartering the bank. And Andrew Jackson hated Henry Clay for a variety of reasons, but most importantly, because he believed Henry Clay had killed his wife. Now, this is another thing to admire about Andrew Jackson. He defended his wife violently at times. He fought a duel with a guy because he insulted his wife. And he wanted to kill Henry Clay because Henry Clay had, he thought, killed his wife. During the presidential campaign against John Quincy Adams in the first go-around, the second go-around, I should say, Clay had written a newspaper ad through other allies that essentially had called out Rachel Jackson as being a bigamist because she was still married when she married Andrew Jackson. Now, this was true. And so Jackson believed that this particular accusation had caused his wife to have a heart attack because of the stress. It was probably something to do with that. So Jackson hated Henry Clay, never forgave him for that. And he was, very interested in defending his friends and family. Jackson was an extremely loyal person to his friends and family. And I mean, I think for that, you can admire him too. But Jackson vetoed the bank. He wrote a beautiful veto message. Without a doubt, it's one of the best veto messages in American history. And it has some great things in it. But he didn't veto the bank because he didn't believe in the bank. He, in fact, ran at one point saying, I support the Bank of the United States. And this is why David Crockett called him out on it and said, you're being inconsistent. You're a hypocrite. So Jackson was not principled in that way. He was simply against the bank because Henry Clay was for it. The other thing that you can say that's good about Andrew Jackson was that the United States was debt-free for the only time in American history during the Jackson administration. And Jackson did believe in a limited federal budget. So he was Jeffersonian that way. And if you look at his rhetoric was very much Jeffersonian at points during his administration. As I said, his veto message for the bank is beautiful. It's a great veto message, one of the best in American history. But we shouldn't give him too much credit for that because Jackson was simply acting the way that Jackson always did. This was a personal matter. And his Celtic heritage, really came into play there. Jackson, the Celts believed in strong personal government. And this is how he governed. He was a man that came from an area that believed in small communities, small clans, and strong personal leadership, and the best soldiers were often elevated to those positions. So General Jackson, as he preferred to be called, was simply following his background here in the executive branch. But there's a reason why his opponents called him King Andrew. Because Andrew Jackson wielded tremendous executive power and actually established a blueprint in many ways that led to people like Lincoln and Teddy Roosevelt and take your pick in the 20th century. Andrew Jackson was a real watershed in American history for that. Now, I also say in this book that George Washington was in some cases behind this too, but only because he was under the influence of Alexander Hamilton. And I get into all those stories in more detail and how Alexander Hamilton screwed up America. So you want to get the class because I get into all that stuff too. But Andrew Jackson, when he became president, did a couple of things that were pretty bad. First and foremost, after he vetoed the bank bill and he wanted the bank to die, Jackson did something that was very unorthodox. In fact, he broke the law by doing it. The bank was going to fail in its recharter, and it was going to go out of existence in 1836 as the central banking system of the United States. Before that happened, though, Andrew Jackson instructed his Secretary of the Treasury to withdraw all of the United States deposits out of the bank. This was illegal. And so he went through a couple of Treasury secretaries who refused to do it. He just fired them until he got a guy who would do it. And that guy was Roger Taney, later more famous or infamous as a Supreme Court justice, depending on your perspective of Taney. But Taney decided to do it as Secretary of the Treasury, and this was 100% illegal. So Jackson was breaking the law, if for any other reason. I mean, this was executive abuse. Now, we can look at it and say, well, this was good. I mean, he's going after the bank. But what he did, though, was disrupt the entire financial sector of the United States, which was only saved during the Van Buren administration and beyond when we finally had an independent treasury, something that Van Buren advocated and finally we got during the Polk administration. But it took some time, so there was a panic in the 1830s because of this financial disruption that Andrew Jackson caused illegally. So here we have executive abuse. So I mentioned that in the book, Nine Presidents Who Screwed Up America. Now, the other thing that that Jackson did, of course, which in my opinion was much more egregious, was his actions during the quote-unquote nullification crisis of 1832. So Jackson decides in 1832, as South Carolina nullifies the tariff of what they called, in 1828, there was a tariff of abominations, and the tariff kept going up. Now, Jackson was probably sympathetic with the argument that the tariff was too high, but what he didn't want was a challenge to his authority, and so Andrew Jackson decided he wanted to use force to collect the revenue. Now, so we get into this issue of nullification here in 1832, and you've had people go out and say, well, nullification is lawlessness. You can't do that. It's lawlessness. Now, what happened with nullification in 1832? The people of South Carolina called a convention. This is the forgotten part of the entire process. They called a convention. The state legislature of South Carolina did not nullify the tariff. The people of South Carolina nullified the tariff. They called a convention, voted people to participate in this convention, and the convention nullified the tariff. Now, Calhoun's perception of nullification was different than Madison's perception of nullification. Calhoun did believe that if one state nullified the tariff, then that tariff was nullified throughout the entire United States. That's not what Madison and Jefferson said. They simply said that they weren't going to enforce it within their borders of Virginia and Kentucky, but if they wanted to collect it somewhere else, or, you know, whatever the law was, they wanted to enforce the law somewhere else, they were free to do so. One state could not void a law for all states. That's Calhoun's position, and I think that we can debate whether that was a good position or not. But Calhoun said that. Now, South Carolina did not say the tariff was nullified for anywhere else, just for the state of South Carolina. And then, of course, Jackson decides that this is an affront to his authority. So he wants Congress to not only lower the tariff, but also pass a piece of legislation called the Force Bill. Essentially, Jackson wants to march the army into South Carolina and hang these traitors in his mind. You know, he considered nullification to be treason. Now, was it? I would say it wasn't. And if you go back and look at the ratification debates, even people like Alexander Hamilton during those debates said that the states would not have to enforce unconstitutional laws. And South Carolina is saying this law is unconstitutional. So who decides? If the states don't have to do it, well, then the states, he's basically alluding to the fact that states themselves can decide, the people of the states, if a law is unconstitutional. And that's exactly what happened here in South Carolina. So the Congress passes a reduced tariff, but also passes the Force Bill. The Force Bill would have allowed Jackson to march the army into South Carolina if the tariff was still not collected. So what does South Carolina do? Well, they call another convention. They meet. They rescind their ordinance of nullification for the tariff and then nullify the Force Bill and adjourn. So they still say, you know what, nullification is still there. The Force Bill is illegal. It's unconstitutional. And we're not going to enforce that in the state of South Carolina either. And so Jackson claimed victory. He said, well, here it is. The leaders in Congress, the Whigs, people like Henry Clay, they said, yep, here it is, we won. We've got Clay was, of course, a national Republican at this point, but you were starting to see the seeds of the Whig Party being sown here because the people in South Carolina started calling Andrew Jackson King Andrew, and of course, anyone who supported Andrew Jackson were Tories. That's what they said, and they start using this term Whig, which came from British politics. The Whigs were the country party, the opposition party to the king. And that's why, so the first time you start seeing Whig used was in South Carolina. That name would then carry out to the quote-unquote national level, and then eventually you would have the Whig Party. But that was actually born in South Carolina in their opposition to Andrew Jackson. So Jackson claims victory, but in fact, nullification worked because the tariff was reduced. That's all South Carolina wanted anyways, and they nullified the force bill. So this was a victory for nullification. And this is, again, this when Lincoln comes into office in 1861, he looks back and looks at Andrew Jackson's actions as a model. Or he goes back and he looks at Washington's actions during the Whiskey Rebellion, which Washington reluctantly did, if you have to read the history of that. Washington was not necessarily interested in force in 1794. But Alexander Hamilton was, and which is why Washington eventually conceded, okay, we'll use force, but you go out and do all the dirty work, Hamilton. I'm not going to do this. So this was the interesting part, of course, of the Whiskey Rebellion, and I get into that in the book, and also the class. If you get order two or more books, you get the class, so I go into that. But here we have Andrew Jackson abusing power. This is why I say he's one of the presidents who screwed up America. He is a real American hero, as is in his efforts as a soldier defending American lives and property on the frontier, but he was not when it came to being president. So Jackson is a mixed bag. But no, in no way should Andrew Jackson ever, his statue ever be removed from New Orleans, Louisiana, because he was so much responsible for defending that city during the War of 1812 in the Battle of New Orleans in January 1815. And so I thought it'd be a good idea to put that out there, because there's a lot of people who just think that Jackson was, you know, the guy who hunted Indians for sport. He didn't do that. Now, of course, one thing I didn't mention, you also had the Trail of Tears, which did not take place during the Jackson administration. It took place after Jackson was already out of office during the Van Buren administration. And that's a whole other issue in of itself. And I will say this about that. The Cherokee are often the group that everyone focuses on during this Trail of Tears. If you go back and you read the documents around that, first of all, Winfield Scott was in charge of removing the Cherokee from Georgia. And you could say that the state of Georgia might have been acting illegally here in violating treaties that had been made with the Cherokee. And Jackson, of course, supported Georgia in this effort, even though the Supreme Court sided against Georgia. But if you read the documents, Winfield Scott wrote that there was very little abuse. The Georgia militia was highly abusive to the Cherokee, but he really tried to stamp that out as military commander. And Winfield Scott, again, he's also one of my real American heroes, one of the most underrated of all American generals. He, in fact, at one time was just as popular as George Washington himself. He was a lieutenant general, which the only other person who ever achieved that rank at that point was George Washington. So here's a guy that was a very prominent and popular American general, popular with his men too. People love Winfield Scott. And so I tend to believe Scott. I don't think that there's much in the way that would show Scott to be a liar. Do I think abuse has occurred? Yes, from the Georgia militia, but it's probably somewhere in between what the Cherokee wrote and what Winfield Scott wrote. I think that Scott was being honest when he said, you know, he tried to stop this stuff from happening. But there was also other Trail of Tears. There was a Creek Trail of Tears. They were sent out of Alabama, for example, to the Oklahoma Territory. The Seminole Indians were sent out. So there was all kinds of these different different groups. The Choctaw and the Chickasaw were sent to Oklahoma. What's interesting about the Cherokee is they were given the biggest chunk of land and a tremendous amount of money, more than any other group. So the Cherokee actually came out better than any of the other Indian tribes that were sent to Oklahoma. We can look at this as because of the violation of the treaties. And of course, sending these people out into basically a reservation system was tragic. But I don't think Jackson was ever hunting Indians for sport. There's no evidence of that. Was he? Did he not like Indians? Certainly. But that was a dominant trend in America at that point, not just Andrew Jackson. We can't just hold Andrew Jackson accountable for the views of the vast majority of Americans in 1832 or 1836 or 1838 or 1813 or 1776. This is what Americans thought of American Indians, United States citizens thought of American Indians in general. So I think that this is a poor excuse to remove a statue of Andrew Jackson or get Jackson off the $20 bill, which is what's going to happen. You know, Jackson should be removed for a lot more than that, as far as a bad president. But as a real American hero, he is one of them. And so we're going to have Jackson off the 20. Anyways, so I think that Jackson should be recognized as a hero. His statue should stay, and you should know the complexities of Jackson before you go out and simply make stupid statements like Jackson hunted Indians for sport. There's no evidence of that. But that's what millennials think today. So I hope there are some millennials listening to this podcast, and they can say, you know, Jackson was a mixed bag, but his statue should stay there in New Orleans. That would be my hope. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed this episode of the Brion McClanahan Show. I'll see you next time.